What did the ancients know of their great men? Just faces in profile on coins. They could only see reflections of their faces. Printing them on paper marked the start of the modern age. Photography was invented in 1839. Soon after, portrait studios sprang up in England and the United States. The dream became a reality. But what do our faces say? What do they reveal? In 1843, David Hill, a painter from Edinburgh, visited Adamson's Calotype Studio and suggested a partnership that was due to last until Adamson's death in 1848 at the age of 27. Charles Dodgson, better known as Lewis Carroll, author and mathematician, was fascinated by children. He wrote Alice in Wonderland for Alice Liddell, the daughter of one of his friends, and made her one of his first models. He photographed a few celebrities, but young girls were his favorite subject, and portrait photography was his passion.
Portraiture is one of the ways in which photography began. In other words, that the camera was used very widely before the invention of photography as a means of recording the likeness of a person. Before the invention of photography, there was a huge fascination in Europe with silhouettes. So photography really began, partly at least, as a way of making likenesses of people.
At the age of 48, Julia Margaret Cameron took up photography. Her peers criticized her lack of technique. "My only wish is to record all the beauty I come across," she replied.
In the 19th century, with photographic portraiture, it does perform a very similar function. In other words, it shows the social position of the person photographed, and that person would often be photographed in a way which reflected their power, their influence, their prestige. People wanted to send portraits of themselves to loved ones. In an age when perhaps there were more arranged marriages, people also wanted to pass around portraits. So life was perhaps also a bit shorter for most people then. Babies died, children often died, very high infant mortality rates, quite high mortality rates in Europe generally. So there was a fascination with keeping a record of what somebody looked like as a way, if you like, of remembering them.
Cameron strove to attain the dramatic intensity of old paintings. By the mid-19th century, portrait photography became more widespread. Professional studios sprang up, the most popular of which was that of Desdéry, who, for a modest sum, offered a portrait-cum-calling card. All the studios tried to attract the more well-off customers. For instance, Nadar moved to the prestigious Boulevard des Capucines. He invented the psychological portrait photograph. He talked to the subject, generally a friend, then suddenly interrupted the conversation when he thought that the subject had the right attitude. His aim was to show the individual's character rather than his mere identity. Great men of the day considered it essential to have their photograph taken. Étienne Carjat, a friend and rival of Nadar, also rejected any kind of decor or backdrop and photographed a gallery of contemporary celebrities. In 1900 appeared the first work of a photographer who's known as the greatest portraitist of the century, Edward Steichen.
I brought up a portfolio with fear and trembling, and wrote, I looked at it, and seemed to be very much interested, said some nice things about them, and so I turned to him with great gusto and enthusiasm. I said, the greatest ambition of my life, master, is to make a photograph of you. and he put his hand on my shoulder and turned to Fritz and said, "You see, Fritz, enthusiasm isn't dead yet in this world," which was very nice, and I can just hear it today yet.
Count Maeterlinck, the Belgian symbolist playwright, wrote of him, "The sun has revealed to us his ability to make portraits of objects and beings faster and more precisely than the pen. But today, it seems that reason has found a flaw through which it can penetrate the mystery of this nameless force and encourage it to say things that have not yet been expressed in the twilight world of grace, beauty, and truth."
He began as an artistic photographer. A friend of Stieglitz's, part of the pictorialist movement of the late 19th century, making very, very, very strong, very powerful symbolist imagery in the pictorialist mode. A lot of manipulation in the image, gun bichromate, brushed photographs, and then became an advertising photographer in the 1920s and changed his style completely towards the new modernist-influenced, very hard-edged, very precise, very objective sort of imagery.
Garbo came in off the set. The director says, "Now you have only 5 minutes." I said, "All right." So I had a kitchen chair there for her to sit on. I draped my black frequency cloth over the back. I asked her to sit on that chair. She sat on the chair, and like a good sport, she straddled the chair, leaned her arm on the back facing me. And then I started the photograph, and I was getting, she would turn her head this way and shake her head this way. And I was, this wasn't the Garbo that I was interested in. This was the regular Hollywood Garbo. So I said, "It's too bad we have to photograph all these things with the hairdo that you wear, the thing, this Hollywood hairdo." She said, "Oh, this hair," put her hand up to her head and brushed them back. And I said, "Greta, now let's make a photograph of that." The good sport again that she was, she went into it, and those are the only pictures I have ever used of Greta Garbo. Long ago came to the conclusion that if you could get one moment that the of reality shining out of that person, that was as much as you could get in the portrait, and then you had something essential.
The dynamism of the interwar years, combined with the birth of the cinema's mythical figures, provoked a new interest in portrait photography. In the 1930s in the United States, the Hollywood studios sought to lionize their stars. The watchwords were glamour and mystery in the pursuit of the absolute dream, the artificial paradise of seduction. In France, portrait photography exploded in the late 40s, the most famous example being Arcor Studios. The critic, Roland Barthes, went as far as to say, "In France, you're not an actor until you've been photographed by Arcor." In their pantheon of stars, the characters were all photographed with the same camera angle and the same lighting. The set photographer Roger Corbeau photographed 160 movies, many of which are now considered classics. He imposed his own style, not hesitating to modify scenery and lighting to serve his own artistic universe. Brassai arrived in Paris from Hungary during the Surrealistic Revolution, but he maintained that he only sought to express reality, for nothing is more surreal.
"All this talk of naturalness and posing is rather strange, in my opinion. To me, it's a cliché, because when the photographer photographs you, the natural thing is for him to look at you and what you're doing. When he says, 'Just pretend I'm not here,' that's a joke, isn't it? When you look into a camera, it's almost like sculpture. You turn into a statue. That, to me, is what portrait photography is about."
Brassai photographed Parisian nightlife before turning to Paris by day, but his concern was always to portray atmospheres and magical moments with sincerity. There are days, Robert Doisneau said, when the simple act of seeing is sheer joy. Even though he arranged certain scenes, Doisneau liked to define himself as a gatherer of images. He isolated fragments of time in banal situations in which daily life seemed to be freed from its shackles. It's true, he added, that I sometimes borrowed the hidden treasure that my peers unknowingly possessed, which admittedly made things easier for me.
You get in position and wait for people to appear in the little black box. It happens all by itself. I was born in the slums of the suburbs. As a child, I was already aware of their ugliness. The suburbs are currently undergoing big changes. A new ugliness is replacing the old ugliness. But to me, the people there are very beautiful in these idiotic surroundings.
The importance of portraiture can be seen also in the nature of the mass media, in the nature of the press, in that virtually every aspect of the press, whatever the story is, people want to personalize that story.
In the 60s, a trend that stemmed from the magazines created a new need, naturalism. The tabloid press wanted to reflect the society of the day and show famous people as they were in everyday life. Photographers were interested in the stars, but now they also created them. The studios no longer controlled their subjects, and the paparazzi's zoom lenses made their appearance. The age of famous people was beginning. It was a stroke of luck for Willy Rizzo, the man who loved women.
A newspaper photographer has an appointment at a certain time, and he has to come up with the talent at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, say, because there are photos to take. He takes the photos and rushes them over to the paper. He can't do the shoot again. The photos have to be good, that's all there is to it. You can't say, oh, such and such a thing didn't work, I wasn't feeling well, I was tired, I got to bed late. That is out of the question.
Philip Halsman arrived in the United States, his reputation already established. His photos of celebrities were on the front pages of countless newspapers. He was to do over 100 front page photos for Life magazine. For Claude Azoulay, taking photos of famous people was easy work. He photographed the stars during the carefree years of the booming economy.
What is very interesting about the portrait is that it's always been used for a variety of purposes. I mean, it has a social meaning, it has an economic meaning, it has a political meaning. There are, all of those aspects are in play. The portraits of celebrities, of the famous, the powerful, would also be quite widely distributed, quite widely shown, and would have an influence on the ways other people photographed ordinary individuals. So there would be fashions in portraiture.
Politicians also let themselves be photographed. They realized the importance of photography because it brought them closer to the general public. In doing so, they appeared more accessible, more human. In this photo, Churchill looks like a determined warmonger. In actual fact, he's just sulking because Karsh had taken his cigar away. Yusuf Karsh is a master political portraitist and respects the tradition of the posed portrait. He composes his photos with an obsessive concern for lighting and claims that the secret of a good portrait cannot be explained. Another posed portrait by Seydou Keita, whose photos form a historical overview of Malian society. They correspond exactly to his subject's desire to be photographed with their finest possessions to look as good as possible. To Seydou Keita, photography is art, and art is beauty. Many portrait photographers in New York come from Harper's Bazaar and Vogue. Famous for his perfectionism, Irvin Penn introduced a distance between himself and the subjects. He observes them, but does not wish to know them. He always photographs them against a uniform, gray background, without any special effects. Richard Avedon sees photography as a confrontation. He creates a tension to seize the model's inner truth. Photographic portraits are the image of people who know they're being photographed, according to Avedon. And this knowledge is as much part of the photo as their clothes or expressions.
Portraiture is performance because it seems to imply some kind of lie that conceals the real truth about the sitter. But that's not all. It goes much further than that. The fact is that you can never get at the thing itself, the real nature of the sitter, by stripping away the surface. You can only get beyond the surface by working with the surface. All that you can do is manipulate that surface, gesture, costume, expression, radically and correctly.
In work, I look for something in a face, and what I look for is contradiction. Complexity, things that are contradictory and at the same time connected.
Portraits should be lively, and nothing should distract you from their vision. The same neutral backgrounds as those in the fashion world should be used, enabling the viewer to concentrate on the subject.
As one who's addicted to white backgrounds, it seems odd to me that a gray or tonal background is never described as an empty background. It's so hard with a white background not to let the graphic element take over, to keep it humanistic. It's so hard to give emotional content to something so completely graphic and potentially caricatural, dominated by the hard, unyielding edge. And that, of course, is the challenge and importance of it. It prevents everyone, the artist, the viewer, and the sitter, from using a person's chosen environment, their house, their library, their comfortable chair, as a means of understanding them. If you can make it work successfully, it permits people to become symbolic of themselves.
If these were one of the Stalin portraits, if you were going to die tomorrow morning, do you think you would do anything differently? Why don't you just think that that's what's going to happen?
Avedon's portraits capture the model's mystery and emotion. His perception of photography is similar to his perception of the world. The wounds of time, the wait for death, the obsessions. And despite all that, the only redeeming thing, the ability to give life. If Helmut Newton is more at home in fashion and nude photography, where he can let loose his fantasies and obsessions, he puts the viewer off-scent by mixing classicism and humor in his portraits. He confronts the subject with his own universe and instills his photos with his imagination. According to Jean-Louis Sieff, photography only shows external appearances. A face can look sad to one person, bored to another, and calm to a third. To interpret an image, we all draw upon our own imagination, our memories, and tastes. A third style between tradition and modernity appeared in the 80s. Peggy Sirota's style is simple and unpretentious. She likes photos which evoke a feeling of freedom. In addition to her fashion and advertising work, she's done portraits of all the Hollywood stars, attempting to see them with a fresh eye. She attributes this creativity to her lack of technical knowledge and only aims to do one thing in her work, provoke emotions. Dominique Isserman started taking photographs during the shooting of Jean-Luc Godard's films. She then moved into fashion and advertising and became one of the best loved photographers to the world's biggest public figures. Bettina Reims was famous for her fashion and advertising work before embarking on a more personal project, treating women's deep, hidden violence.
What I like about photography is that things are never what they seem to be.
Bettina Reims plays with the duality of life, masculine and feminine, tenderness and harshness. Her series on androgynous people was deliberately ambiguous.
I leave a lot of room for spontaneity in a photo shoot. Sometimes people cry or laugh, do things they don't really want to do. But when I photograph stars, I don't do much of that now, but when I do, the stars have the right to choose which photos can be published. So there's a kind of impunity in a photo session, because they know they can go too far, and then they can censor certain pictures afterwards, which can be very frustrating for me.
Patrick de Marchelier doesn't aim for any effect of style or decor. His photographs of the Princess of Wales show her the way we'll always think of her.
When I shoot a portrait, for me, it's more going for the moment with the person. It's really about the inner quality of somebody and their inner soul. It's what you try to bring out of that person and the trust that you set up. With the Dalai Lama, I had 10 minutes in a hotel room once, and it was a great rapport. Madonna, I might have for 2 days doing many, many pictures. But the interesting thing is letting that person be themselves and realizing in very few moments that you have to have that rapport and go for a moment and go for a photograph. So to me, with a portrait, it's important that the person is allowed to come through in the photograph.
Anton Corbijn took his first photos at a concert with his father's camera. He then took portraits of artists for the top magazines. He conceives the photographs in terms of music. As a creator of advertising pictures, video clips, and graphics, he's constantly looking for new, more complete solutions, characteristic of the new generation's passion for multimedia. François-Marie Bagnier began by drawing. He showed his work to Dali, who was so enthusiastic that they became friends. The young prodigy was 15 years old at the time. 4 years later, he published his first novel, Résidence Secondaire, which established his reputation in the literary world. His third gift is photography. His portraits are chance encounters or arranged events which treat the themes of love, solitude, and the passing of time.
I first took photographs to remember unforgettable things and faces that I was afraid would fade away. I don't have a good memory for faces. In the street, for example, when I see a man standing on his own, screaming, his arms raised in despair, his despair feels like my own despair. I can't just let it go, and once I'm back home, write about it, at the corner of the Rue Royale and the Rue du Faubourg Saint-Honoré. That's ridiculous. Writing about it is idiotic. To me, writing is good enough for poor souls like me, whereas photography is unique.
I think that a portrait should be powerful enough to make us want to ask questions about the face we're looking at. Something in the contradictions in the face, in the attitude, and the expressions should make you wonder who this person really is and come up with answers of your own. To me, a portrait is like a huge neon question mark.
Get ready, models, the mask is about to fall. The portraitist, sculptor of your faces, lets others see the texture of your skin up close, lets their eyes look into yours, and search the wrinkles of your inner self. And yet, thanks to these portraits, be they the fruit of chance or design, what a delight to exist forever.